We've come today to Walney Island, near Barrow-in-Furness, at the bottom end of the Lake District, basically. So this is the shore of Walney Island. A pebbly beach. Eva's already barking at rocks down there. This is the Irish Sea. This is a wind farm out there. It is a beach with a bit of sand, but mostly it's these sandstone quartzite pebbles. What's up with you? So it's a beach with cobbles and rock pools and big stretches of yellow sand. Eva's having the time of her life, barking at rocks. Yeah, get it, Em. Now I have seen some razor clam shells just lying loose in amongst all these cobbles. So this looks like it could be a beach where if we come here at the right tide, come here at the very, very low tide, we might find some razor clams. But yeah, we've got some interesting rocks. There's sandstones here. There's some lovely granite. I haven't seen anything that I'm tempted to take and tumble. So we are, this is basically Morecambe Bay down here. Quite famous for its shellfish. So there's probably cockles underneath this sand as well. See, this rock here, I'm inclined to say, could be a kind of jasper or something, or maybe an iron ore of some sort. Some lovely streaks of red in it, although the matrix appears to be quite sandy, so not really sure what that is. So lots of little burrows in the sand here. Most of these will just be little worms and various things like that, but I imagine we might find some razor clams here. I'll have a look. Apparently the way to spot a razor clam is a keyhole shaped hole in the sand. I haven't really seen anything that strikes me as keyhole shaped just yet. I'm not sure whether the tide is coming in or going out, so I would say probably going out, because this part of the beach I'm standing on is already wet. I will check it with the tide table in a minute. Yeah, not seeing any razor clam holes here, but I bet they're around. Maybe a little bit further out when it's a lower tide. But yeah, what a lovely clean beach. Haven't seen a single piece of plastic waste. That's a nice kind of non-discovery. All right, I'm going to cross this bit just down here. You're having a good time, aren't you, Eva? You looking for rocks? I don't think... Oh, you're looking for little shrimpy things. There's little fish and shrimps and things darting about in here. No, I don't think barking will help. That's what you sound like. Those seagulls, Eva, that's what you sound like. So the upper foreshore is different kind of rocks to what I'm used to seeing on the beaches down south. Down in the south of England, we've got a lot of kind of flint and chert. But what we got here is, well, some very nice granite and granitoid. I think the pink in there is potassium feldspar. But yeah, so we got some granitoids. We got, I think the blue grey stuff is sandstone. Oh, a nice kind of brecciated something or other there. It's something that's cracked up and then healed with quartz or calcite. Quite interesting variety of rocks and very pretty. And if you wanted to do your kind of Instagram thing where you stack a stack of flat rocks, this would be the place to do it without anybody complaining, because the tide goes all the way up to that seaweed line there. So if you make your stack of rocks down here, the next tide will undo it and leave it exactly as it was before you arrived. Well, not exactly as it was, but leave it in the same general state as it was before you got here. What's kind of amazing is really the variety of these different rocks. So they're all the same kind of thing, but there's tremendous variety in the actual composition. So I presume these must have come from different flows and formations and whatnot, different layers perhaps in the bedrock. And I think it's true that Walney Island is a sort of glacial formation, so I think there's some sort of glacial activity transported a lot of these rocks quite a long way. So that's probably also partly the reason for all the variety here. Some of these have come quite a long way to be here. And there are, I don't know if that's a bit of hematite. Might be. There are various iron bearing rocks here as well, which have been transported quite a way, I understand. So hematites, possibly jasper. There's a piece of, so I'll just wash that off and have a good look at it. Some of that is feldspar, I think. I don't know, actually. No, that might just be calcite infill. It's a really nice sort of bit of... You can see that was probably a sedimentary rock, and there's been some metamorphosis. It's been transformed, and then it's been smashed up and had quartz or calcite or whatever this white stuff is flow into it and heal it. What a pretty rock. There's a, see, there's another one that's got, don't know what those are. Yeah, don't really know as much about rocks as I talk about rocks, but it's fun to look at them. And every time I make a video like this, of course, your comments about what it was you saw on screen are educational to me, so that's good. I'm not sure whether we're going to get any coastal foraging done today. It's possible. Oh, look at this one. So, I don't know if it's going to come out. Oh, it is moving. So there's a piece that's almost entirely quartz. No, it's not for you. So I think that is made up of the white stuff. Basically, the white crystals in the other rocks we're seeing. I think that is just a piece where that's all of it. That would probably tumble nice and smooth, although it's not especially interesting, and I don't think there'd be anything different inside of that. Also, collecting rocks from here, that's nice. That looks like a piece of blue cheese. Also, there is the whole thing about the legality of collecting rocks from UK shores. There's the Coastal Protection Act, which makes it technically illegal for a toddler to pick up a pebble to take home and paint. In everyday terms, it's not generally enforced like that, but except by pedants. Atomic Shrimp continues to talk about rocks. Here we go, Forbidden Muffin. This one is a piece of sandstone, I think, and it's broken along this line where there'd been a quartz infill. Oh, that's pretty as well, look at that. I don't want to wash off for you. I saw something also interesting behind me, so I mustn't forget that. Look at that. Nice. Actually, not nice. N-I-C-E, nice. But I did also see over here, there's a very good reason why that rock is a brownish orange colour, and that's going to be iron. The presence of iron in that rock, it's rusting out basically. Well, it may already been present as an oxide, but there we go, that's iron oxide making that a rusty brown colour. Look at that one as well, great big chunks of different crystals and things in it, very pretty. If it were possible, I would definitely want to do. Jenny's idea is, what about if you got all of these different rocks and built a house out of them? All the different colours and patterns and blends of colours would make a really interesting wall. I'm not even tempted to try that. Nice idea as that is. Because, well, yeah, you're not, just not allowed to do that. But also, how am I going to carry all this lot back to the car? And this one might have tumbling potential. But I don't know. I think some of this grey stuff here is sandstone and won't take a shine. Now, it just occurred to me, Jenny's amazingly fine idea of building a house from all these different coloured rocks here. Whilst we can't do that in physical reality, we definitely can do something like that. So I'm going to go around, take a photograph of all of these different shades of rock, and here's what a wall might look like if you built it out of all of these. Okay, so this is a game, is it? Right. So I get that out of the hole and throw it. Eva digs the beach away from under it. It's a bit big for you. And then go all the way back here and put it in the hole. And bark at it, yeah, good plan. Just down here in the water you can see some little tracks on the sand there, and I think what that is these fellas here, these common periwinkles. Thank you, Eva. And well, there's one of them up on a rock. Actually, they might not all be common periwinkle, they might be top shells, some of them quite similar sort of little snails. This one's covered in barnacles. You can see it's got a little door there, keeping the snail protected from, well, most kinds of predator.
That's called an operculum, which is Latin for door. Anyway, these little things in the rock pool zoom around, grazing on bits of algae and various other stuff, and that's what's causing these little tracks down here, apart from the tracks made by this little snail. I've just seen this rock here. Actually, I'm going to get a different rock for Eva. Right. Let's get a... different rock for Eva. You go and get busy with that, because I think this is a piece of porphyry. So porphyritic crystals inside of there. Although obviously also something that's quite, that's weathered out quite easily. Unless of course those holes are the remains of gas bubbles. But yeah, that looks like a crystal that would make this rock a porphyry. Eva. She is having the time of her life. In terms of foraging potential, wild radish here. We've had the pods off of that before. Another one there. That's a wild radish. Down here on the beach, sea beet. We may have some of this today actually. Might pick a little bit of sea beet on the way back. Yeah, that looks nice. Nice, smallish, very fresh green leaves there. So we might pick a bit of that. Maybe take it home and see what we can make out of it. There's another one there. Same species of plant as beetroot and perpetual spinach and sugar beet and a bunch of other things as well. Chard. Mangel wurzels. That's sea kale. That's sea kale there. This is edible if you get a chance to blanch it. So if you own a bit of private beach, or if you can grow this on your land at home and cover it over in the spring, so that the, a bit like you do with rhubarb, so the shoots don't get any light, you get these blanched shoots, which are quite nice to eat. If you try and eat the unblanched stuff, it's quite bitter and it's got a really, really strong flavor that you can still taste the next day. These are all the little seed capsules here. Very, very light. And of course, there's a reason for that. These are adapted to float. They're almost like little corks. And so these will detach, and when the tide comes in, or when they blow away, they'll blow off, get floated off somewhere else, washed up on a different bit of beach, and perhaps prevail there. So at the top of the foreshore here on Walney Island, there's a golf course. But it also contains these things. That's, I would say, a World War II gun emplacement of some sort. Pillbox, that kind of thing, defensive structure. There looks to be another one just up on the corner here, so we'll have a wander up, because I think the path might go a little bit closer to that one, so we can maybe get a closer view of it. Here's another, well, technically forageable thing. This is called sea holly, eryngium. And it's not actually related to holly. The roots of this used to be dug up, and it's got a starchy root that looks a little bit like a parsnip or something maybe. And people used to candy them and make a kind of sweet confection called eryngos. I won't be doing that today because, well, as I quite often say, we're not allowed to dig up wild plants in the UK in general without the landowner's permission. There's a younger specimen there. There is one of the seed heads fallen off all on its own. It's a nice plant, and people do grow sea holly as a decorative plant in the garden. So I think maybe I'll pick up this seed head, take that home. There's no reason why I can't do that. And maybe grow it in the garden, and maybe we'll get a chance to taste it. Here's another potential forageable. Roses, Rosa rugosa, not native, called the beach rose, and here it is growing on the beach. It is a bit of an invasive plant, but it does have these wonderful big fat, these are quite small actually because of where it's growing, but these big fat red rose hips, which can be made into juice or jelly. Very rich in vitamin C. And the petals, of course, are edible as well. So you can make rose petal jam, you can make rose water out of the petals. Quite fragrant. Oh, I think there's an aerodrome somewhere near here. I can hear roaring sounds like jet planes taking off. Some lovely sea beet down there. I think we might pick from that one on the way back. So we're coming up to this structure. Some bramble growing right on the beach here, so blackberries as well, forageable. Wouldn't pick them from there actually, there's probably better ones inland. I can see some radish pods down there. So I think I will just scramble down this little wall here. Here we go. So these are, Eva, be quiet. These are wild radish pods. Edible. Quite fiery and peppery, quite radishy, as you might imagine. But crisp. Sort of hot mustard flavour. Sometimes they only have one seed in like that. Wow, wow, that's like horseradish, that one. That grew on me. There's a seed in the middle. That one's just a tiny bit tough, so that one was a bit too big. Here's one that's dried out, so I could take that home, get the seed out. I could grow this plant, but I don't intend to. I think it's better just have a little nibble on them while we're foraging. Really, really nice, tasty salad sort of accent, this wild plant. Lovely, crisp, intensely radishy flavoured pods. A much larger rose rugosa with some lovely rose hips on it there. Since we're on holiday, I haven't really got the means to do anything with these rose hips, but that's a shame, because these look like they'd be good picking. There's some really ripe ones there that would be no trouble at all to prepare. When they're as ripe as that and they're all wrinkly, you can kind of squeeze the seeds out of them, and you can prepare them without having to bother to use a knife. You just kind of squeeze them, get the seeds out, and cook the flesh. I mean, you can cook the whole lot and strain it.
Oh, that's the defensive structure. I feel sure that that was a gun emplacement. There is a kind of path up there, so I think it would be a shame to come all this way. Oh, a piece of plastic bottle, can you believe it? And without clambering up here and having a look inside. I don't suppose there's going to be very much to see inside of that. Ooh. But kind of unusual to find one of these things open in a way that you could actually get in there. Yeah, so there would have been a gun here, which has got 180 degrees plus of view of the whole of the peninsula here. And there is a door around here as well. Well, that's interesting. Okay. So yeah, that would have been the way in. Jenny's down there. Oh. Well, how about that for a view? Let's take a look down the side of here. Generation after generation of youths have had fires in here and smashed bottles and opened tubes of tomato puree. That must be a thing the kids are doing these days. I don't think Jenny's noticed where I am at the moment. So there we are. That's what it would have looked like from here. This is the gun emplacement on Walney Island. Missing, obviously, is a, there probably would have been a big, heavy steel door here. And probably another one here. so that if this was under attack, they could close some blast doors and take refuge, or obviously retreat out the back or something like that. So right, come on in, this way. Down here. Down here, Eva. So yeah, up on the golf course there, something else concrete over there, more than likely another one of these structures, possibly defending the bit of the harbour that goes around the corner there, which I think is the port for Barrow & Furness. Barrow & Furness is quite a significant seaport. Okay, apparently he even knows the way down. So just around the corner, comes into another little bay here. The seawall with a big hole in it. Quite a lot of rubbish and debris on this part of the beach. That's a sad thing to see. Unfortunately, we're not here to pick up much of that today. I'll pick up what I can and put it in the bin locally, but... Eva, this way. Come on. You're having a great time, aren't you? Up at the top of the beach here, there are these interesting, very, very porous rocks. Here's a good example of one. It weighs almost nothing. I imagine that would probably float in water. I don't think that's a natural rock. I think that's a piece of slag that's been dumped here from steel working, so, or a piece of kind of coke or cinder from a furnace. There's a piece that's clearly been burnt. So I reckon from steelworks locally or something, maybe they used to dump their slag in the sea somewhere around here and it washed here. So yeah, you can hear it. It's got a glassy sound to it. So, well, I think I might take this piece here actually, because I reckon that would look really nice planted up with a little cactus or something in the top. You can see actually also there's where it's been poured. That's been the top surface of it when it was poured, probably. So I haven't got a problem with taking that home. So nice sea beet here, rather small leaves, but it'll be lovely. So I'm gonna pick a load of this. Got a bag in my wallet. Fortune favors the prepared. So yeah, we'll pick some nice leaves of sea beet. We'll get them back to Atomic Shrimp Temporary Lodge and see what we can do with them. Okay, so back at the kitchen of Atomic Shrimp Temporary HQ, which has a chandelier, we're just going to put this sea beet in some cold water. So later on today, I'll cook something with this, but for now, I'll just immerse it in some nice cold water, give it a soak in there. That will loosen up any dust and sand and grit and whatnot that's stuck on it, and then I'll rinse it again and then we can cook it later. But it's looking really nice. It's lovely sea beet, look at that. Couldn't want for better. So we got this amazing sea beet, which I will just drain and then rinse again, and this I'm just going to chop up and then we're going to steam it sort of in its own juices. I've got a bit of leek here. I'm making a vegetable stew to go with the thing I'm preparing here. I've saved the paler end of the leek. We'll cook that together with the sea beet. Didn't bring my own kitchen knives. Kind of wish I did. This knife is not sharp. But we're on holiday. We've got to make the best we can. So extra care to mitigate the extra pressure I'm having to add to cut through just these leaves. So a little bit of butter in a pan, and I'll put the sea beet on top. And I'll also mix in some of this leek. It's really difficult cutting this with this blunt knife, so extra care, I'd say. So leek and sea beet. That's not all of the sea beet. We're going to put some more in there in a minute. I have my travelling spice kit with me, so we'll have a little bit of salt.
And then over here at this frankly amazing range cooker, that's the sea beet and leeks in there. The closest I have to a wooden spoon is a rubber spatula. And just a little splash of water in there just so it doesn't burn. That, and I had a tiny little sprinkle of pepper, not much. Just a pinch. Right, so this cooked leek and sea beet mixture, it's just been kind of steaming and poaching in its own juice, plus a little bit of water I did add. So now I'm going to give it a squeeze against the side of the pan. Actually, quite a good utensil for that. So after having complained about the knives, here's one I am happier with. All right, so we'll get that out. That's now cooked. I'll set that aside in a different bowl. Just try and separate it from the juice. This juice that I've squeezed out, I'll probably put it in the stew because it's got some flavour. Although obviously we do risk then making a meal and its accompaniment that tastes the same. Just see if I can squeeze any more juice out of this because it's kind of important. So Barrow & Furness, where we're staying, is in the ceremonial county of Cumbria, but the historic county of Lancashire. This is not an episode of Map Men, so I've got some Lancashire cheese here. And Lancashire is one of those crumbly cheeses. It's a crumbly white cheese. It's going to be perfect to go with sea beet. I'm going to taste a little bit of this cheese. Nice sort of mild acidity and creaminess, and not as salty as some other crumbly white cheeses. And as best I can, I'll mix those ingredients together. I just lost a bit of cheese into the sink. We could have a bit more cheese, maybe. Wish I'd brought nutmeg with me now, because sea beet is essentially spinach. Spinach, cheese, and nutmeg is a winning combination. So just a little bit more cheese. I'll just mash that together. And the residual warmth of the sea beet is just going to melt that cheese a little bit. And you can probably hear traffic noise in the background. We are obviously staying in a lodge, which means it's right by a road. That's just the nature of the thing. It does calm down a little bit in the evening. So now I'm just going to take some of this sea beet and leek and cheese mixture, squeeze any last bit of moisture out of it, kind of form it into a shape that's going to fit on a slice of bread. And looks about right. Okay. Maybe a little bit more. Just got to share this out between two. Okay. The other slice of bread on top. This is just cheap white bread. I'll try and give that a squish down, because what I want to do is crimp the edge down. It's quite doughy bread, so hopefully this will seal. I'm not going to trim the crusts off, because I don't think that's going to leave me enough bread to work with. Okay, I think we've made a little bread parcel of cheese and vegetables there. Second verse, same as the first. Right, this kitchen is equipped with an air fryer. So I'm going to brush that with a bit of butter, melted butter somehow, and then we're going to air fry it. Okay, I think they said about 8 minutes, no, 10 minutes in the air fryer. Let's have a look. That actually looks pretty good. I think we'll take that one out and do the other one now. Okay, so two kind of air fried sandwiches with sea beet, leek, and Lancashire cheese in them. Two bowls of hearty stew. I'm particularly interested to know what this will taste like. I think we'll let Jenny have that one because that's the nicer looking of the two, but they're both equally crispy and cheesy and sea beety. Let's give it a taste. Okay, there's one of those for you.
Thank you.
And there's one for me. Cheers. Danny's doing the cut, so let's see what the inside looks like. Oh, it's held together, so there it is. Okay, it might be kind of cheesy vegetable napalm, so be careful. I'm going to cut mine on the diagonal because it's all fancy-like. Well, I can say the air fryer has made it incredibly crispy on the outside. So let's have a little taste. Mmm. Oh, wow. That is actually really good.
Mmm.
Yeah? Mm-hmm. The cheese has just melted, but not quite. Perfect. Happy with that. So there we go. That's Foraged Sea Beet Toastie from Walney Island.
Anyway, just to wrap up the video, we're back here at Bigger Village, or Bigar. And the question about what would it look like if you picked up a bunch of those rocks off the beach and built a house, which was Jenny's idea and a fine idea, it turns out the question's answered, because here's an example of an old barn that's been built from local stones, just clearly the rounded stones that you find on the beach. So there we go, that's what it would look like. That one's obviously been built quite a long time ago, Queen's Arms, but there's a barn there. Yeah, quite an old building, that one. Obviously you can tell from the lichens on there, but for a slightly newer example of a building built from local stones, there we go. Tiny little bit of an issue there with that wall. In fact, two issues. One is a massive crack running up it. The other is, as you can see, these rounded stones don't really tie into the wall all that well. And so one of them's just popped out there. So whilst these rounded cobbles boulders are very pretty, and especially because they're in such a variety of colours, they're not necessarily the best building material. But they do look nice. Anyway, I hope this has been interesting. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you again soon.